Okay, the next presentation is about greater amberjack, and it's going to be given by Nikos Papandroulakis from HCMR.
Thank you, Dinos. So, good morning from my side. Also, I'm going to present you the work we did on the amberjack. My name is Nikos Papandroulakis, and I have been the species leader in this project for amberjack. Why amberjack is a good candidate? I'm not going to repeat again the all about diversification. The species has some interesting characteristics. It's very fast growing. It has a growth rate that sometimes reaches 10 times more than the European sea bass. It has a good flesh quality. Some people say that it's excellent. And it has a global market. And of course, it has significant potential for export. As congener species are produced commercially elsewhere all over the world. And because of the large size, we are going to repeat it continuously, it's suitable for the development of value-added products. Greater amberjack in the Mediterranean started in the 80s with capture-based activities from wild juveniles, where fish of about 90 grams were brought to cages where traditional practices have been applied. In 2016, according to FAO, the production was about 500 tons, with hatchery produced individuals in Malta and also in Spain. And it was an expressed interest for this species by various companies in Spain, Greece, Italy, Turkey, and etc. And about the market price, we knew that it was higher than 14 euro per kilo for capture fisheries. So when Diversify started, we have identified the major bottlenecks by making a survey in the Mediterranean. And we have seen that we had problems in reproduction. There were some, we could reproduce the fish in captivity with hormonal treatments and in some cases spontaneously, but we don't have a reliable reproduction methodology. We couldn't produce adequate numbers of juveniles, although some semi-intensive methods have been developed, but with very low survival rate. And we have significant incidents with fish health, with several pathogens from bacteria and also parasites. So when we started, we promised to do work on reproduction and to develop spawning induction methods. Larval husbandry rearing protocols, work on nutrition and identify enrichment diets for live food, diets for weaning grow out and broodstock, grow out husbandry, feeding strategies, husbandry for cages, rearing and so on, and of course work on health and consumer and market analysis. I'm not going to present you all the results that we have achieved during the project. There is a manual that we have created that it is available online, and I know that Rocio is going to present all the work we did with the dissemination activities later on. So I'm going to give you an outlook of some of the, let's say, the most interesting results that we have until now. From in broodstock management, there is a huge group of partners that have been working. Both from research and also from academia, but also from the private sector. The work has been led by HCMR, Dinos. And initially, they studied the reproductive cycle, both in wild in Italy and also in captivity in Greece. They have created several broodstocks that serve us to do the work during the whole project. You see, there were most of the broodstocks were in private farms, but also some of them were in our facility, in HCMR. And initially, the idea was to keep fish either in cages or in tanks and induce the spawning during the appropriate season and then collect the eggs either in tanks or cages. Because of some problems that we have faced by collecting the fish, the eggs in a cage, a new approach was identified to keep the fish in the cages during the whole year, and then during the appropriate period, induce the spawning, transfer them immediately in land-based facility, in tanks, collect the eggs, and then bring the fish back in the cages. We have developed some methodology to collect eggs from cages, but it is far from being an effective methodology in the sense that we were never able to collect all the eggs that were produced by the fish there. So the recommended protocol: keep the fish in the sea cages during the year, induce spawning after late May until early July, use generates implant at appropriate dose every 2 weeks, transfer immediately to land-based tanks, collect the eggs, and return to cages after spawning. About nutrition, again, a large group of institutions, led by the group in Las Palmas, have been working on this. For the hatchery, they have worked on to determine the DHA and DPA levels and the carotenoids for the enrichment product for rotifer and artemia. And this is what they came for. They have identified the percentage required for DHA, EPA, the DHA EPA ratio, and also the carotenoids. They have been working for the broodstock feeding in order to optimize reproduction. And in particular, they have been working with the protein levels, histine, taurine, and also the DHA EPA levels. And this is what they came up. So we have a recipe, let's say, for the diet in terms of histine content, taurine content, levels of proteins, and then the EPA, DHA levels. For the hatchery production, that was identified as one of the major problems. Again, it was a group of research and private institutions that have been working, led by HCMR. What were the objectives for at this stage is to acquire basic biological information, because we are lacking this information regarding the endogeny of the various biological systems of the fish, like the digestion and the vision system, the somatotropic axis, and of course the skeletal endogeny. We have been working on the feeding regime and the prey enriching diet, and we have tried to work and identify the husbandry parameters related to tank type and shape, stocking density, light conditions. What we have learned by studying the basic biology of the species is that these guys have a fast early transition to juveniles, just after 5.5 millimeter in total length. Protein is the main energy source since the first feeding. They have night vision after 5 millimeter. Rotifer seems to be a very appropriate diet, and we have some difficulty to adapt to artemia, but still we can work with this. And then from all the parameters that we have been working, I'm going to show you here the work we did with the background color of the tank, where we have results quite significant in terms of survival. It has a significant effect, the light during the larva rearing. And it, for some reasons that still needs to be clearly understood, we have, let's say, we have identified a significant technological step for the larva rearing, and we are able now to produce high numbers of juveniles in intensive conditions. Following this, we have been towards the identification of industrial protocol. We have been working with two commercial hatcheries, and they have been able, in both cases, to produce several dozens of thousands of individuals that has been transferred in cages. Of course, they have identified difficulties related mostly to the handling of the individuals, and we came up with a list of recommendations for the rearing parameters in terms of tank size, stocking densities, pH, temperature, photophase, light intensity, and so on, feeding, and husbandry practice. One of the major issues that we have also with this species, as with the migra, as Alethea said before, is the size variability. we need to sort the fish as early as 20 days post-hatching in order to create appropriate groups of individuals and to get the survival. We have learned some small issues, but that are significant for the producers. Larvae cannot tolerate netting at a specific period of their life, so you need to identify other methods of doing the sorting. And of course, after larval rearing, we have done some work on the grow out. And first of all, we wanted to see if the species have some temperature tolerance ranges, and then to develop practices for the sea cages. Again, a work together, academia and private sector. The first results on the temperature tolerance, we have seen that individuals between 20 and 300 grams perform better at 26. They have a better morphology also, and an improved swimming efficiency, while individuals after 350 up to 600 grams perform better at 21, while at higher temperatures seems to display a compensatory growth. This is also in accordance to what we have in practice, because during summer, when the individuals start the rearing, we have high temperature, and then this is the size 6 months later when we have, let's say, the winter, the spring, where 21 is the temperature that you expect to have a few months later when the individuals are at these size ranges. Rearing in cages, real commercial cage and commercial trials with several thousand of individuals. You see the work we did in two different farms, and one of the main issues that we faced is that although we have sorted and we have created, let's say, one size individuals when we introduce them in cages, 4 months later we had individuals from 100 to 800 grams in the same group. So we need to sort them out, create two groups, the small and the big ones, and you see here the growth performance of the two groups, significant difference. This is the size distribution at harvesting, 18 months post-hatching. The big guys had an average, the majority of the individuals are in the range of 2 to 3 kilos, while the small ones are in the range of 1 to 2 kilo. So it's a significant parameter for the producer. It's 1 kilo difference, and we need to work out on this. And if I'm trying to summarize in this traffic-light approach, green, the good, and red, orange, the problematic situation for the rearing in commercial cages. Because, you know, at the beginning we thought that amberjacking cages is straightforward. Everybody do it, we can do it. It seems easy, but it's not the case. Okay, the good thing is that, yeah, we can feed commercial diet. And especially if it is high protein and can produce, that can be produced in commercial scale, everything is okay. There is no problem with the standard husbandry practices, net clinging, changing, stocking density at about 5 kilos, which for a pelagic fish seems to be appropriate. And then problematic. We have a lot of problems. We have a lot of parasites, but the Lys catharios is going to give you a more detailed presentation in the afternoon on the problems that we have faced. Although we have learned to treat the fish with peroxide, still we have problems because it's not very easy to apply this type of methodologies in big cages. And we have also bacterial infections. But still, there is a commercial potential for this species, and this is something that we have to keep in mind. Health. Just highlights. Padelis is going to discuss this in the afternoon. But we have been working on the immune system. We have identified a problem with epitheliocystis. we have studied the vibriosis and also the parasites. There is a lot of work that has been done in the market and the new product. Hematakin is going to present the work afterwards. But just to give you again an idea, we have identified three product ideas for greater amberjack. fresh fillet receive the highest score out of this. And regarding consumer acceptance, it seems that we need to present our product to the customers to give them more, to learn more before introducing a new product in the market. So, okay, we did a lot, but there are still room to do. There are still a lot of things to do. First, we have the biological barriers, the nutrition. We need to go further and study all the different stages in production, from breeders, larvae, and ongrowing. For the reproduction, we need off-season egg production, because otherwise the industry is not going to be sustainable. We need to reproduce the fish in lab-bait facilities, it's easier. And of course, we need to have natural spawning. Larva rearing and ongrowing, the same thing. Size variability in husbandry practices, appropriate husbandry practices. Pathology, prevention scheme, and oral treatments, oral administration. Marketing, again, it's going to be discussed later, but we need to develop a trademark. And we don't want amberjack to be one more fish in the market. We want amberjack to be the base for more fish products. We have to have in mind the example of salmon. Now, for this, we need the coordination between producers. Not only the academia, but the producers themselves need to coordinate for the site selection, for the pathology management, and the promotion of the product. We don't need to repeat the mistakes we did in the past. And I thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to answer questions if there are.
Thank you very much, Nikos. Nice video. Very nice. Okay, questions from the audience. Yes, Ivar.
I think I can speak. You don't mention that, I mean, the ungrowing production in recirculation system, wouldn't that be an issue to solve some of the problems you mentioned?
This is a big discussion, and considering that this species is mostly dedicated for the Mediterranean, I don't think that this can be a solution for us. We need to work on the cages because this is how the industry works. I know that there are some trials with not greater amberjack, but other species of amberjack in Denmark and in the Netherlands. I'm not sure about the economic efficiency of this system of production. I know that there have been some efforts in Saudi Arabia with greater amberjack that they failed, huge. So I think that the line that we have started working, we need to continue, and we need to identify appropriate sites for the species that is most probably should be a little offshore that will reduce the problem with the parasites and makes our life a little easier.
I can join on this question. I agree with Nikos that for the Mediterranean area and for the established industry, I think we should continue looking into the cage production. We know this is an efficient method, and we have the water, we have the expertise, so I think that we should continue on that. What is important, though, is to identify the correct sites. Not all sites are appropriate, probably. It's a pelagic fish. Maybe we need to go more offshore. Maybe we need to go eastern in the Mediterranean, where the temperatures are higher for a longer period of time to have better growth. Now, on the flip side of that, I'm not saying that recirculation aquaculture is a no-no for this fish. My opinion is that it is a good idea. It is a very good idea because it will solve the problem of the pathology, which is very significant. So I do believe that the recirculation aquaculture has a role for this fish, not for the Mediterranean countries, of course, but other locations. And it has been done, it has been tested in Turkey. I've seen fish that are 12 months old and they're 3 kilos because you can prevent the pathology and you can maintain the optimal temperature in recirculation systems. Now, whether it's efficient, you know, cost effective, I don't know. The industry will have that. But my belief is that, yes, we should continue for sea cages in the Mediterranean. Yes, we should consider a recirculation aquaculture system for this fish. It's a good one, I think. Bjorn, you want to next up?
Yeah, I remember when we started in Spain in 1990 farming fish, the first fish we tried was actually amberjack. And those days we had wild juveniles, and they wouldn't take the pellets we had, so we had to feed them trash fish. But they grew very well in, we caught them in August, and they grew to maybe half a kilo in by November. And then we lost 50% during the winter due to low temperatures. I think temperature is an issue that really have to be addressed. What is the lethal temperature? I think 13, 14 with the feed we were giving is about the lower limit.
Maybe so even higher.
Maybe higher.
No, we have increased the last couple of years. I'm just waiting for you to conclude, and then I'm going to summarize what you said.
Yeah, okay.
Unless you want to interrupt
so
you,
so
it's okay.
I think that's the low temperature has to be addressed. Also, the other thing is the high FCR, if you have experienced that. I looked on the reports, and they were quite high for bigger fish. That's an issue. We have seen the road. I wonder if it's the same as we saw with cobia. Bigger fish is more difficult to get the low FCR, and size will be important there. And we also should look on what they've done in other countries, like Japan. They farm still 150,000 tons of a similar species, and they have a big catalogue of diseases. They have a 60-page booklet you can get with all the diseases you can think of. So that would be continue to be an issue. So I have been thinking to address the well, one is partly the disease, but also the temperature. Maybe the answer would be to have year-round spawning. You need to start to manipulate the temperature and light so you get broodstock year-round so you can produce juveniles. You maybe the first winter keep in recirculation aquaculture, and then you move them into the sea, into cages. Because it's obvious to me that recirculating aquaculture RAS have a much higher investments, and I'm not sure you can afford to do that for this, for certainly no market size, but maybe the juveniles and the first winter, and then into cages, which definitely would be cheaper than farming fish in
Thank you very much for your comments. I really appreciate what you said. I'm just going to give you some information from what we have collected until now. Temperature is an issue, and that's why we have been working with the to find the appropriate temperature ranges. We have been working until as low as 15, which seems that the fish grow without any problem. If the and from our experience in cages, we have been down to 12 degrees, again without problem, provided that we have individuals more than half kilo. That means that if the grow out for the first six months is appropriate and we have individuals of more than 6 kilo, then we can tolerate the 2 months of harsh, let's say, low temperature period without significant losses. The major issue that we have faced is the pathology related to parasites. And I don't remember if in this presentation I gave you some idea of the FCR that we have succeeded. It's about 2. But this is the commercial FCR that includes all the losses of the fish that we have. So biologically speaking, the FCR is about 1.4, 1.5, and can be improved significantly. And that's why we want to work a little bit also on the nutrition of the species further. Now, the husbandry practice and how we are going to manage, it's certainly a good idea to have on land the fish for the first period of ongrowing, but this depends again on the time of the year that we are going to have the spawning. It's absolutely important, all the comments, and we have them in mind. And of course, we gain all the information from Japan, although the species there are a little different. King radiata is not dumerili, but still we get the experience there.
More questions?
I wanted to also point out in the area of reproduction, what Nikos presented was mainly the work that we did in the Mediterranean. And with the Mediterranean stocks, what we have found is that it's not easy to undergo maturation and spawn when the fish are maintained in tanks. And that's why we had this hybrid approach of maintaining the fish in the cages and then bringing them into tanks for spawning only. But when the same fish, or seemingly the same fish, is maintained in the Atlantic Ocean, in the Canary Islands, both in Tenerife and in Las Palmas, it does not exhibit this behavior, and the fish do undergo maturation, and they do undergo even spontaneous spawning in captivity. So just so that I won't leave you with the idea that there's absolutely no tank spawning in this fish, but also to bring the point that we may have a different type of fish there, and that the environment has different effect. We have, because of these differences, put in our work as an additional task to look at the genetics of the different populations, and we have looked at the genetics of the different populations, and we have indeed found that one of the stocks in the Canary Islands is different genetically, from a population genetics aspect, from the Mediterranean. Now, whether this results in the different reproductive biology, we're not sure, but keeping the fish in the relatively low amplitude temperature fluctuation of the tropical areas and the low amplitude fluctuations of the photoperiod does different things to the reproductive biology of the fish, and may do different things on the growth, and I don't know what other parameters. So we have to be aware that this is a fish that exists throughout the world, and it does different things, and it experiences different things around the world. So there may be different stocks, and different stocks, different genes may do different things. We're still very, very early on this fish, and there may be considerable improvements in our production performance, FCR being one, reproductive period may be another one. So we're still very early in this area.
Correct, and not only this, we have to remember that the first work that has been published back in 2004 for the reproduction of the species in captivity, it was in the Mediterranean by Dinos and myself, and we have the fish in tanks. So we have succeeded reproduction in tanks, but it was different, the water quality. Right. So not only the environment, the water quality, everything has a role. It's a very new species, and we need to learn a lot on this still. So there is plenty of room to work with the species further.
I like the idea that Mr. Marshall said about considering the possibility of doing like part of the cycle on land, like they do with halibut, which is like a three-stage cycle, two on cages, two on land, one in cages. I don't know the economics of it, whether it will be efficient, but I think it's important. It may be important both from the aspect of the growth, okay, of the pathology, but also if you want to have a continuous production, like off-season production, I don't think we can do it with this fish under natural sea cage production, because I don't think that it's possible, or it would be a good idea to produce fish in December and throw them in the sea in March when the temperature is 16 degrees at this size. So maybe we're okay with sea bass and sea bream because they're winter fish and we can put them in the sea anytime we want. But with that, with the amberjack, we're probably limited in when we're putting them in the sea. It has to be between, I would say, June and October or November. So by going on land for a period of the cycle, it may be a necessity at the end if we want to have a more year-round production.
Yeah, but still, if you have the reproduction, let's say in January, you have the fish ready in April, and then everything is okay, it's easier. We need first to have the reproduction out of season, and then we decide how we're going to work it out and see the economics and everything. But still, it's a necessity that that we have to go for this. And then we have to consider also what you said, which is obvious.